Just give it a second. Welcome, everyone. This is Awesome Hardware. This is a live show. Kyle and I do it every Tuesday evening. We stream it live to twitch.tv/awesomehardware, primarily. We've also been streaming live to each of our individual channels, so you're actually watching episode 46, second half, or side B. If you missed the first half or side A, it's over on Kyle's channel. If you're watching live, then after this you can go watch his half. If you're watching in the future, then watch his half now. I don't know, it's the best explanation I can give. Yeah. Anyway, we're going to talk about technology, and we're going to drink some beers. We've already been drinking some beers.
Yes, we have.
It's going to be fantastic. It's lovely.
By the way, we didn't do Johnson shoutouts on my half, but I didn't really have any during the episode, although I did have one or two from earlier today, which thank you guys for ordering. Let's see. Ryan, thank you for picking up a CPU cooler shirt.
Beautiful, Ryan.
Appreciate that as well. As Martin picked up two Stay Positive shirts and a CPU cooler shirt. Awesome. Thank you, sir. Appreciate that, guys.
I can't check my Johnson's because it's doing that thing where I won't let me log in unless I change my password.
I hate it.
I don't want to do that right now.
Don't you hate it when your Johnson's password protected?
So, hey, thanks to any of you guys who have bought any stuff from our stores. Speaking of stores, I did not resize this yet, so it's still the wrong size. Hold on. Yay, there it goes. Being tiny.
That's so weird that it got hung up.
I don't know, but it's fixed now, so that's good.
Okay.
Kyle's store is awesomesaucenetwork.com/store. He has shirts and some hoodies, as well as the ever-popular CP Cooler shirt and Stay Positive shirt. Check those out. My store is store.paulshardware.net. I've also got some hoodies, some t-shirts. I also have some glassware and accessories. So if you like the lovely Imperial pint glasses we're drinking out of here, or also mugs, you can check those out on my store. Okay, enough of all that.
Woop, woop, woop.
Let's move on to the first segment of my half of the show. Usually the second half starts off with news, and hey, we're not gonna mess with what works, right? So let's do some tech news.
Let's do it.
What's new in tech, Kyle?
Your face.
My face is new in technology.
Yep.
To some degree.
That's what I said.
Perhaps. Let me make sure I have notes up so I can sound like I know what I'm talking about.
I don't know. Let's see what's new. AM4. AM4 is new.
AM4 is exciting.
That's what's new.
All right, let's talk about that.
Baby.
So AM4, this is a OC3D.net article. I believe it was originally... What was that noise? It's very noisy. I believe this is originally a WCCF Tech article.
That's completely false.
It's that weird little whistly noise.
I don't know.
Did you hear it?
Yeah, it was like, wee, wee. It was like hollering at us.
I don't know where that came from.
Kind of insulting.
Anyway, AM4 is the name for AMD's new platform. And what this article is saying is basically it's going to be a unified platform for both their CPUs and their APUs.
Yes.
I am very happy about this.
Yes.
I was hoping they would do this, and now this article seems to be confirming it. So, for instance, whereas before they had AMD FX processors or the AM3 Plus socket,
right,
which worked with their CPUs, and then they had FM2 Plus as well as AM1,
right,
which would work with various APUs, now they're just going to have AM4.
Yeah.
CPUs, APUs, both slot in. To me, what this means is that you can buy an AM4 motherboard and, say, a low-end APU, get yourself off the ground with the working system, and then in the future, invest in like a higher-end CPU that doesn't have an integrated graphics, like maybe something Zen-based in the future, and then also drop in a graphics card. So for me, because I always look for like, I love to have that upgrade path whenever you're setting up a new system, and this seems like an ideal solution for that. I've built quite a few AM or FM2 Plus systems using APUs, and I've always been like, hey, drop the graphics card in the layer later on, and like, it works, but I always feel like the CPU performance of them still isn't all that good.
You can only put in such a great graphics card before you start seeing some bottleneck issues with the APU.
Yes.
Or, yeah.
Depending on the situation. So, again, this is pretty early, but still good news from what I can tell. This will allow AMD's future users to easily transition from one CPU to another without changing their motherboard. It also means that it's a unified platform for AMD.
Yeah.
Which means that on AMD's side, there's not as many motherboards to worry about developing. On the motherboard manufacturer's side, it means that they can spend more time on each individual motherboard rather than having to worry about different lines,
right,
which means wonderful things for stuff like BIOS updates, for example. From a motherboard manufacturer's perspective, it takes time and effort and man hours to go into like updating BIOSes and that kind of thing.
Yeah.
And if there are fewer motherboards to worry about, then there's a better chance that you'll get more updates.
It's like being an only child. You get all the attention.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Very. Kyle's an only child, so that makes perfect sense.
Forever alone.
Anyway, we've heard some rumors that AM4 might be coming as early as 2016. I don't want to say too much, but I kind of threw that around a little bit with some people I was talking to at CES, and the impression I got was that's pretty optimistic.
Yeah.
So I'm not expecting anything until probably Computex timeframe
next year would be
my guess. Who knows, though? Maybe we'll see some stuff earlier than that.
Oh, this year. Computex this year.
This year. Right. It's definitely this year. It has to be this year.
Yeah.
It cannot not be this year. Right. Will we see any boards in March? I'm skeptical.
TBD.
But April, May, and probably June, most likely. The first CPUs coming out on for this platform are going to be Excavator-based, which is the existing CPU architecture.
Yeah.
And the code name is Bristol Ridge. And what we're expecting to see is probably CPUs or APUs are both based on earlier pre-Zen architecture first on the platform, but then it will also be compatible with Zen-based stuff coming up in the future.
Gotcha.
And again, Zen was something that I tried to ask around. We did go to AMD at CES. They really weren't saying much about Zen. That was, yeah.
It was like definitely a big part of the reason why I didn't stop by the AMD booth, because that was like what I really wanted to find out, and I was like, I feel like they're going to be tight-lipped about that.
They did have a Polaris demo, pretty freaking nice.
Yeah,
it was the
ridiculous TDP.
Yeah, when it comes to like, hey, that's a pretty nice proof of concept there. It was a pretty compelling demo. Yeah. But anyway, though, let's move on. Here's another bit of CES news. This is just some randomness that popped up midweek and thought I'd throw it in here.
Oh, yeah.
The U.S. Marshals raided a CES booth, which was a little bit unprecedented. This is an Ars Technica article. And Future Motion is a company that makes hoverboards, or I don't know if they call them hoverboards or not. They make this little single-wheeled...
Uniboards.
Hoverboard or uniboard or whatever. The company that Future Motion sued is called Changzhou First International Trade Company. And that is the company whose booth was raided at CES. So basically, Future Motion said, this company is over here showcasing a product that's basically a complete ripoff of our product that we already have patents on. The lawyers filed their motion in federal court in Las Vegas on Tuesday, which is the Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, so, which is the day before the first day of CES. They had a hearing by telephone on Wednesday, which is the first day of CES. The hearing lasted 7 minutes.
Oh, my God.
Which is amazingly quick. And then a U.S. District Judge, Miranda Du, issued an order that Changzhou's products be seized and that it stop sales.
How does such a big decision like this get through in 7 minutes? Like, I've had longer conversations on the phone with my wife about which milk to get. Which brand of, like, soup we should go with.
It's weird when it comes to the court system, but it seems like it's either agonizingly slow or, like, surprisingly fast.
There's got to be some influence there.
Yeah, I don't know exactly what it is. Anyway, so U.S. Marshals came in. They quietly disassembled the Changzhou booth and seized 5 to 6 scooters that they were that they had there for demos, as well as some marketing materials. The reason it was exceptionally fast is that the motion that was filed by Future Motion filed a motion.
Right.
Just kind of. It was specifically saying like that the harm that's coming about here is specifically for the CES show. So by letting them be there for even a day or two and letting them get exposure for their product, that's what's gonna cause harm to Future Motion and their product and everything. Anyway.
Jesus.
So Future Motion's one-wheel scooter first debuted at CES 2 years ago. They raised more than $630,000 on Kickstarter. And they begin selling the one wheel in late December 2014. You can now buy it on their website for $1,500.
This is the Future Motion one?
Yeah, this is the Future Motion one that's right here. And
the Chinese one's probably like $100.
This one to me is not quite as egregious as all the damn hoverboards that are everywhere.
Yeah, that's true.
This one at least you have to balance a little bit. I don't know.
Looks very DIY in that shot.
Anyway, the main reason we brought this up is because of the quick court action and the fact that the U.S. Marshals reported to something at CES and sees stuff. Anyway, here's a TechWorm article. This is sent over by DDT2005 on Twitter. So thank you, sir, for sending this over to us yesterday. This is Intel's new Broadwell E processor.
Yes.
And this stuff is still early, so, you know, grain of salt and all that good stuff. But it seems like we have some pretty solid details on Intel's newest line of processors. This is going to be a 10-core.
Sweet.
10. That is two more than the current 8-core processor that you can get that's Haswell E, the 5960X, the fastest or most expensive, well, both fastest and most expensive Intel processor on the market.
Yeah.
Anyway, I guess there's no more pictures in this article. I'll just leave it on this one. Look at that picture. It's beautiful.
It is.
Anyway, though, so Broadwell E. First off, I know it's not Skylake E, but Broadwell, even though the consumer release of it was so, like, just this narrow little sliver between Haswell E
and
Skylake, there was still some pretty cool stuff about it. So we still have a lot of expectations for Broadwell E. It's using the same microarchitecture as Haswell E, but it's shrunk down to 14-nanometer process.
Mm-hmm.
This is the Core i7-6950X, which is going to be the flagship from that generation, as far as we are told. It's going to be compatible with X99 chipset, socket 2011-3 motherboards, so presumably with a BIOS update, you can drop it into your existing X99 build. 10 cores, 20 threads, base clock of 3 GHz, and a 3.5 GHz boost with an unlocked multiplier.
Nice.
So I'm sure there's going to be... I'm going to be very curious to see what types of... what, like, the typical overclock is on something like this. 10 cores, you know, you add the more cores, the more complexity you add, especially in a big chip, the more difficult it can be to overclock. But I mean, if these can hit 4.2 to 4.4 reliably, that's still pretty beastly.
Yeah. Are they coming out with a new chipset for this as well?
No, still going to be X99.
Okay.
Yeah. 140 watt TDP is the thermal design power. And then there's also a couple more processors that are going to also be added to this Broadwell E lineup, the relaunch, it's going to be a CPU launch for the existing X99 platform, which we're expecting probably at Computex in June.
Nice.
And there's also an i7-6900K, which is 8-core, 16-thread, as well as an i7-6850K, which is a 6-core, 12-thread processor.
The 6900K, I mean, it seems like it's Skylake, right? Because, like, the nomenclature and stuff, but
Intel's
a little tricky.
Intel's
there.
Engineering and marketing departments, like, there's definitely a disconnect there, it seems. And yeah, Intel, I don't know what to tell them as far as, like, simplify your naming conventions for your processors,
because doesn't make any sense,
because it's very confusing. I don't know. That's the biggest tip off for me that somebody doesn't know that much about computers is if I ask them, if they're like, oh, I have a gaming system or something, and I say, what is your processor? And they're like, I have an i7.
Yeah.
And I'm like, that could be such a huge range of possible CPUs.
Yeah.
You don't even understand how many Intels are i7s.
It's like, what kind of car do you have? Four-wheel drive.
Yeah. It's crazy. So... yeah. You're right, there's going to be confusion. The fact that these are 6,000
mm-hmm.
as far as the naming convention goes, and they're Broadwell E, whereas you will have Skylake. And then we're also supposed to see Skylake E at some point, too.
Yeah.
But who knows?
Later down the line,
so
probably.
Yeah, still lots of questions there, but hey, 6950X might be $1,500 US, though.
Fool!
God damn it.
Start saving now.
God damn it.
Contact everyone at Intel that I know.
That's always the rub right there, is how much Intel thinks they can... Which is why we need Zen to really kick ass. We really need Zen to kick ass. So when Intel comes out with this, they're like, we need to also sell this at $1,000, which is reasonable. $1,000, yeah. We need Zen to kick ass, so Intel can't pull this kind of crap.
Counting on you, AMD.
Yes. All right, let's move on.
Bring us home.
NVIDIA and AMD... on the graphics card side, both have a little bit of news here. Again, this is a lot of stuff that we've kind of mentioned a little bit, talked about a little bit before. This is a videocards.com article on shipping manifests. And shipping manifests, if you watch the show before, often a way that people will spot early products that like are going through shipping and from different key places. So this one is specifically about Pascal, or the GeForce Pascal series of processors, mm-hmm. which are all going to have GP code names, GP, etc. Since it's right. the first series of Pascal GPUs, they're going to be GP100.
Right.
So this is GP104, which, according to the code name here, should put it on par with what the GM204 would be, which right. is what the 980 is based on. So not the biggest GPU, like the 980 Ti and everything.
But high-end, certainly.
But still high-end, and something that we might assume might be making actual graphics cards that are in the 980 class,
yeah.
for example. Anyway, this is just a shipping manifest coming from Taiwan, and it's got some different code names here and stuff like that. And they do a lot of reading into these shipping manifests on these websites, such as videocards.com, as well as 3D Center, which is where a lot of this information is deriving from, about like the overall sizes of the packages that right. are being shipped in general, how that, like, you know, how that relates to the sizes of the packages from previous generations, and how we can, you know, extrapolate that based on how many GPUs are packed in there and their size and that kind of stuff. So a lot of this stuff, guys, just what I'm saying here is really early and really subject to possible change and a lot of speculation. But
yeah,
from what we can tell, GP104 is GeForce Pascal 104. It's going to be manufactured by TSMC, which is Taiwan Semiconductor Manufacturing Corporation,
right.
which is why the origin country here is Taiwan. These should be double the density based on the die shrink. So they're going down to 16 nanometer from, I want to say 28.
Mm-hmm.
I could be wrong, though. That could be 32. Apologies, brain fart. 28 or 32 nanometers. But the first big die shrink that we've seen from in GPUs in actually several years.
Like five years.
Yeah, they stuck at the same lithography for quite a while.
I mean, stuck at 28 forever.
Yes. So the GP104, according to this, is probably going to be in about a 37.5 by 37.5 millimeter package. That's smaller than the GM204, which is 40 by 40 millimeters. Only a little bit smaller, but smaller. But the listing has revealed that it has more pins than a GM204, 2152 versus 1745. There's also speculation in this article that I'm not going to dive into too much about whether or not these GPUs are using HBM memory.
Right.
Because that's a big question, is HBM memory, how much of it they can produce, and how the big GPU manufacturers are going to allocate the HBM memory to the graphics cards that they're producing. Because yeah. there's not enough of it to go around.
Right.
So, yeah.
It's still probably reserved for, like, the flagship cards from, whether you're talking NVIDIA or AMD.
Yes.
They're probably not going to have it for the entire new Pascal line. It's just going to be for, like, those top-tier yeah. cards.
And that would be my guess. My guess would be, based on what NVIDIA has done in the past, that we'll see something like, we'll see Pascal-based GPUs in the, say, $500 range and down, using GDDR5, GDDR5X, or GDDR6,
yeah,
whatever the case may be. And then we'll see probably from NVIDIA their like top one or two GPUs, like a Titan class one that's $1,000, and then maybe like a 980 Ti equivalent in the next generation that's $650 or $700.
Right.
Which also in the past they'll wait like a few months after the original Titan launches before they launch the 980 Ti class one.
Right.
Anyway, again, that's what I'm assuming. That's based on what they've done in the past and all that kind of thing.
Yeah.
So we're still really not sure, but hey, the upshot here is that they are actually shipping units to for testing.
Things are happening, folks.
Things are happening. AMD.
Be aware.
AMD Polaris. Polaris is the code name for the architecture for AMD's new stuff. So here's another. This is from the same article. More shipping manifests coming from Hong Kong, which should contain printed circuit board assemblies for graphics cards. Anyway, yeah. These are codenamed, at least in the manifest, C980 and C981. These are likely going to be Hawaii XT replacements. That would be like a 390 and 390X replacement in the 400 series. Simply because the cost listed in these manifests is less than what the current manifests say for Fiji-based cards, which are Fury X. So that's kind of cool. Anyway, just knowing that these are shipping out, all the rumors and stuff, you know, they should be coming. Again, we're not sure when, We're not sure where. We're not sure how. But soon.
We're not sure what. No, we know what.
We're not sure of anything. I know nothing.
We know at least what is happening.
Yes.
Sweet.
All right. Here's like I said, guys, I have lots of news, so most of my half is going to be news. So I'm just going to keep running through this a little bit at a time. Let's talk about Amazon's...
So informative, Paul.
Amazon's new thing that they did apparently like today or yesterday.
What did they do?
They basically are giving 20% off all video games for Prime members.
Wait, say that again?
Are you an Amazon Prime member?
Yes.
Then you now get 20% off...
All video games.
All video games.
Sold on... Whether that be... Are they doing digital copies or just hard copies?
I'm glad you asked that because yes. That was one of my questions too.
Leading question.
My questions when I first saw this were... Is this console only? Is this like select right. video games? Is it whatever? No. It seems to be all video games, physical copies.
Okay. I can hang with that.
Which often sell for as much as digital copies for right. new games.
Yeah.
I'll have to install an optical drive
into Hotline.
Exactly. I'm pushing the completely wrong button there.
But I can't. It doesn't have a 5 1/4-inch bay.
Yeah,
exactly. I'll have to get an external one, which I'll buy with Prime. Hey.
Yeah,
I see what they did there. I see it.
All right, so...
I see the vision.
Pretty
this
sweet
cool, though.
If you're already a Prime member,
yeah.
which I am. So yeah, 20% off. All right, so here's the two caveats.
Yeah.
One is this is for pre-orders and the 2 weeks after launch.
Okay.
So I was glad about that.
Yeah, it's not bad.
At first I saw it and I was like, if this is only for pre-orders, I'm going to be mad.
Yeah, right.
Because I don't want to have to pre-order a game to get 20% discount. But right. it's the pre-order and 2 weeks after launch.
That's fair because then you can yeah. see all the reviews that have come out yeah. from reputable sources
wait
to
week,
see whether or
wait
not it's
week,
a good
check
game.
The reviews. If yeah. it's a good game, then pull the trigger.
Cool.
And then the other thing is that it's physical copies only.
Sure.
So apart from that, it seems to be...
Get an external ODD, yeah. y'all.
It Hop seems to be it. Everything. It seems to be PC games, console games,
right
across the board. So hey,
sweet
Amazon once when, again leveraging their
sheer
massive
mass.
massive customer base and everything. But right. hey, 20% off games. I'm not going to complain about.
So what?
Nobody pre-orders still. Don't take this as an incentive to pre-order. Take advantage of that week or two after launch.
So when exactly is this going to take effect?
What?
When is this exactly going to take effect?
Now.
Now. It's already there? It's good?
As far as I can tell. I got all congested all of a sudden, sorry.
Sweet.
Yeah, right now.
Alright. Well, guys, use either of our affiliate links to go ahead and purchase an external optical drive so that you can start getting those games for a discounted price.
Indeed.
And installing them hard style.
I agree. Yeah. Alright.
Yeah.
Moving right along.
Remix OS is having the design.
Remix OS. Hold on.
That vape mess you up?
Yeah, apparently.
Good.
The vape that Kyle forced me to use his vape at the end of his half of the show.
That's what you get for sucking
it's,
at game.
It's having all kinds of repercussions on my health. All right, Remix OS. All right, so there's a company called Jide. J-I-D-E.
Jihad?
No, it's not Jihad.
Oh, Jide. Got it.
Apparently last year at CES they had effectively a Surface clone.
Okay.
Microsoft Surface. This year they have something that's a little bit more compelling.
What's that?
Which is a new operating system based on Android.
Okay.
So, yeah, they have this device called a Remix, and they did a Kickstarter in 2015 for the Remix Mini, which is a $70 device that you can see right here. Which can run Android on any screen that has an HDMI input. So similar to a lot of like the compute sticks and that kind of thing.
Sure.
But $70 and you know it has a certain amount of features and it took in about $1.6 million on their Kickstarter. So they did pretty decent there.
This is a very saturated market. What makes them so different?
I don't know what made them so different. Maybe you featured them on To Fund or Not To Fund. And that's what gave them all sorts of traffic and that kind
anything
of
thing. Anything we feature on that segment usually,
it immediately
usually
gets
tanks just yeah. in the next month.
Anyway, though, so Remix OS is what the Remix Mini is based on, but Jide went one step further, and basically they're offering this for anyone to use on any x86-based computer.
Huh.
So basically, you can load this up off of a memory stick.
Yeah.
And pop in there, and then you've got...
You just boot into it.
Yeah, you've got sort of a uniquely skinned fork of Android that has cool desktop-oriented features like what you can see here, which is them actually doing things in Windows, dragging and dropping. It's got like a kind of your Windows bar type thing across the bottom, and has an interface that a lot more people who are comfortable with desktop use would be more familiar with. You can right click, for example. Quite a few people who took a look at this at CES were fairly impressed with it. So,
assuming you've got your Corsair lapdog in the living room with you.
Yeah, you have a lapdog.
Right, go ahead and mouse around with the desktop on your TV, on your 4K screen.
Yeah, so nice. I don't know if this is free. It seems like it's free to download, and you can just try it out, and you can run it off of a memory stick.
Nice.
And it seems like a pretty cool feature for something that you might have just written off as like, oh, another like kind of compute stick type thing. But yeah, it seems like maybe even a method of like a DIY Chromebook or something like that.
Yeah.
I don't know, something to that effect. And I'm sure there's tons more like applications for this type of thing that I can't think of.
Or like
right
if
now.
You built a really low powered HTPC, but you didn't install a operating system on it, like you didn't buy Windows or you didn't want to like go to, you know, download Linux or whatever, you could technically just boot off of this flash drive in tandem with your HTPC and have a fully fledged operating system.
Yeah.
Sweet.
That's pretty cool. And it's x86, so that's another cool thing. But anyway.
Cool.
Thought I'd show that to you guys.
Dig it.
Let's move on here.
Nailed it.
Terrible news. Terrible, terrible news.
Oh, joy. This should be on the Ojoy segment.
I know. I was going to make an Ojoy segment. I didn't have enough terrible news, though. here's a gamer who has blamed an NVIDIA GPU driver bug for showing the porn that they previously viewed via a Chrome...
Oh, yeah. I read this.
Via a Chrome incognito window.
I read the headline. Does this mean he, like, was streaming and, he, like, it showed up a bunch of porn because of a glitch?
No.
Oh,
it means he was viewing porn via a Chrome incognito window.
I've always wondered what that's like.
He closed out the window and then later on went to load Diablo.
Yeah.
And instead of the Diablo splash screen, he saw the last view of the porn he was looking at. And I assume his whole family was standing there watching him. They're like, what's that in the Diablo loading screen? You were going to show us your...
Dios mío!
You're going to show us the unique drops that you just recently... God, I don't know. I haven't played
Diablo.
He's
like, no.
In 7 years.
Madre, it's Diablo. He's like, we know it's the devil.
Apparently, he's also Spanish. This guy.
Fun fact. I like the porn.
Yeah. I like the porn button.
It's going to be like just a new feature built into all mechanical
this
keyboards.
This was something I did not spot at CES. I was surprised.
Was
none of these new mechanical keyboards just have that direct access porn button.
Huge dearth of porn buttons.
So this is basically a bug in NVIDIA's GPU drivers. The GPU memory is not being erased before handing it over to the application, which allows the contents of one application, in this case a Chrome incognito window.
So it was like in the cache.
Yeah.
Basically, it was just...
Well, it's in the GPU's frame buffer.
Right.
Which leaks over to the other. So when the Chrome incognito window is closed, the frame buffer was added to the pool of free GPU memory, but was not erased. When Diablo requested a frame buffer of its own, NVIDIA offered the one previously used by Chrome. Since it wasn't erased, it still contained the previous contents, and Diablo... So, like, there's certain things that could have happened along this chain to block it. Like Diablo, for example... The software could have requested to clear the buffer before doing whatever, but it didn't. It just pulled up whatever was
fuck
there.
It. We'll do it live. Yeah.
Yeah. So there's the article itself points fingers in a few different locations, but ultimately here, what could solve this is an NVIDIA driver update for this, because this happens across multiple operating systems, and apparently this has been reported since 2015. This ongoing problem. But I think we all need to unite together to rise up against this terrible injustice and force NVIDIA to update their drivers so that we are no longer fearful next time, presumably.
Who knows who might be watching next time you try to fire up Diablo 3.
An incognito window.
So the Wickle porn drivers are still haven't been released yet?
No, not yet.
Okay.
We're still waiting. Waiting on you, NVIDIA. Okay.
Your move.
Let's move on to another news article. Look how much news there is. This one I would have put in a... I never went back to full screen there. This one I would have put into a Tales from the Future or whatever type thing.
Tales from Space? Or
anyway.
Tech of the Day After Tomorrow?
I'm going to try to pronounce this. Endohedral fullerenes. Fullerenes?
Like dodecahedron.
So this is now the second most expensive substance on Earth.
I want it.
$167 million per gram.
Maybe we could get the scientist to sponsor our show and give us a gram of this shit.
And why is he holding it inside one of those large hexagonal dog toys that they sell at PetSmart?
Because he's on drugs.
Anyway, Designer Carbon Materials is an Oxford-based scientific startup. And they recently sold their first 200 micrograms of this of these endohedral fullerenes.
Okay.
For £22,000.
Jesus.
That's $33,400, or about $167 million per gram.
So this is like acid on acid.
It's acid on acid.
Acid squared.
It's not exact. It doesn't have quite the same practical application as acid.
LSD.
No. There's no LSD involved.
Stop it.
This is the only picture I have to show either. All right. So... Aside from this material being obscenely expensive, what is the actual practical use for it?
Yeah. Recreational use.
It's used for making atomic clocks, or it could be used to make for making atomic clocks. Atomic clocks are like, I don't know how they work. I can't explain to you how they work. All I know is they're insanely accurate clocks. But right now the technology to make an atomic clock takes up about the size of like a room to fill up with the It's like vacuum tubes.
So this is a pretty niche substance here.
Yeah, but atomic clocks are also very important because, for instance, in applications like GPSs, they're measuring the amount of time that a signal takes to get from point A to point B. If the clocks are precisely synchronized, then they can be much more accurate in their measurements. Does that make sense?
I'm still thinking about how much blow you could get for $33,000.
You could get a lot of blow.
I don't know if that really...
A lot of blow. It'd be worth
it. GPS.
In case you guys are wondering, I think I mentioned this. The second most valuable material on Earth, preceded only by antimatter, which is estimated by NASA to cost about 41 trillion pounds per gram. That's 41 trillion English pounds.
I'm saving up.
Which in U.S. dollars, I think
I'll
is about...
There. More than
100
that.
Trillion. I don't know. The pound is strong.
More trillions.
So anyway, this substance could possibly be used in the future to make a very tiny atomic clock that could fit in your smartphone.
Mm.
So for mobile devices, for example, as I was mentioning, GPSs, driverless cars is another thing mentioned in the article. Right now, GPSs can get with an accuracy of within like a yard or maybe a meter-ish or two.
Sure.
This will allow accuracy within a few millimeters rather than that. So much more pinpoint accuracy, which for stuff like driverless cars, as well as cell phones and that kind of thing, could be very, very useful. Obviously, it's insanely expensive right now, so you're not necessarily going to be seeing a endofullerenes GPS-based Samsung Galaxy S7 or whatever. But it's coming in the future, and this is material synthesized, so... what are they? It's like a group of carbon atoms that encase another atom or something like that. I don't know.
An atom gangbang?
Actually, yeah, it's basically like an atomic gangbang.
It's like molecular level Brazzers.
Exactly. Exactly.
I can dig it.
That's what they're going for.
Yeah.
All that accuracy.
Precise aim.
Okay.
Cool.
Here's my last news article.
All right.
Right?
Yeah.
Last news article.
Yeah. What? No. I don't like this headline.
This is a Torrent Freak article, which is very upsetting to Kyle, which says, no more pirated games. No more pirated games in 2 years.
Why?
Warns the cracking group, or at least the founder of the notorious Chinese cracking forum, 3DM.
What? No.
Is warning that the current state of anti-piracy technology, or with the current state of anti-piracy technology, there might be no more pirated games within a couple of years.
Bullshit.
That's bullshit, according to Kyle.
What is their reasoning for that?
Kyle relies heavily on pirated games.
I do. Actually,
according to the comments in last, it was a week or two ago, you're very far too honest about
my piracy.
About your pirating habits. That's okay though. All right, Yar. So Just Cause 3 is the latest game to use the latest iteration of Denuvo. D-E-N-U-V-O, which is an anti-tampering technology developed by Denuvo Software Solutions. Just Cause 3 was released December 1st, 2015, and it has not been cracked yet.
Right.
There are no cracked versions of Just Cause 3. It's been...
That's pretty...
It's
impressive.
Been like 5 or 6 weeks.
Right.
That's a pretty significant amount of time.
It's amazing.
Unprecedented.
This group, this Chinese cracking group, 3DM, brought down a previous instance of Denuvo, but the... excuse me. I need to drink water.
The vape. Long live the vape.
It's that damn vape.
Yep.
It just builds up in there.
Okay,
sorry about that. I probably sound like my dad right now.
Clean your room, Paul.
Okay. Chinese cracking group 3DM has brought down a previous instance of Denuvo software, but the Austria-based company has continued to tweak it. They've achieved increasing protection periods on recent games, including the FIFA series, which is apparently about soccer.
Yeah.
Or football Americano.
Football.
Football. FIFA 16 is currently Denuvo protected, and that game also still has not been cracked, and that was released in September.
Wow.
So these hackers are either getting lazy, or the software is getting really, really, really difficult to crack.
Or they hate soccer games.
The article, or they just really, like, why would we bother to crack a soccer game?
FIFA?
Everyone who was in the UK and everywhere else is like, it's called football. Damn Americans.
Football
Americano.
Not like your football.
Anyway, yeah, the article goes on to, it talks about like the actual guy, like their kind of head cracker guy. Sorry, white people who I said cracker about.
The head
guy in their cracking team was basically like, yeah, it pushed the group's cracking expert to breaking point. Like he was gonna go insane and instead of cracking it or something like that. Anyway,
cracker in charge.
So yeah, not too much further to be said here, but who knows? Maybe the protection that they're putting on these games has gotten so bad that they won't be cracked again. The thought here is that yes, it will be cracked eventually, but that because the protection is so strong, it will now take months to crack instead of much less time.
At least at first.
And since people like Kyle who download pirated games are so impatient...
I do not download pirated games.
Since Kyle...
They're usually movies and
TV
shows.
Okay, movies and TV shows. Since people are so impatient to get access to these cracked things that they will have moved on to buying the games instead. I don't know. Who knows?
Yeah. And for the record, I only pirate things that I absolutely cannot get through manageable means. So, for example, if there's something on Amazon or Netflix that I can watch...
And they charge money for it? It's like, why would I pay money?
I'm a member of Netflix.
Okay,
I'm a member of Amazon Prime. So between those two things, if there's anything that's there, I don't like want to hoard it and download it and like keep it for my personal saving... But if there's something like...
But if it's not there on your free streaming service, you're like, it should be there, therefore
it's not a free streaming service, though, Paul. I'm paying for it.
For your paid streaming services.
And here's the thing. I can't justify paying for an entire cable subscription for 200,000-plus channels if I'm only going to be interested in, like, 0.003% of the content. I just won't have it. I don't agree with that business model, and I won't support it. So yeah, if they're gonna try to dick me over like that, then I will download a fucking TV show if I want to see it. If it's not offered on the other platforms that I already pay for.
You are correct that the outdated business model of cable television content delivery drives people to other means of obtaining content.
Yes.
Okay. Let's move on.
True.
Time for sword fight. Yay,
let's do it.
It's another segment.
Sword fight.
Also, my habit
is piracy one of the topics.
No.
That'd be a good one. One day,
it would piracy. Be a good topic for sword fight.
Yeah, which side I'd argue.
We could have a swashbuckling sword fight. All right. Hold on. I need
hang you by your loots and grab your booty.
What?
I don't know. Oh, donuts.
Hold on, I didn't click on my I didn't click on my straw poll. Where's my straw poll? Straw poll.
What do we got?
Where'd it go?
Alright, VR. Cost of VR.
I got
it. So this VR, I'll set you up, buddy.
Click it.
Oh, you've got like articles and shit?
Yes, I have an article.
Okay, so you probably got some like.
No, I'm just trying to copy
about
this so I can paste it into Twitch chat.
Alright.
Twitch chat. Yay.
So what we're talking about right now for Sword Fight, the first Sword Fight anyway for today, is VR. When would you buy a VR headset?
Yes. Or so,
HMD.
According to this report, this is articles from Android Authority.
Yeah.
Damn, the HTC Vive might be expensive. Again, this is early. This is not confirmed. We don't know this for sure, but this is a rumor. And I'm also pasting this into YouTube chat right now. $1,500, which is more than double the cost of what the Oculus Rift is selling for right now.
Right.
And is that too much? Is that too much for people? Will that drive people to pirate the HTC Vive? No. Is that too much? I mean, I saw a big old fuss get thrown up when the $600 price point of the Oculus came out.
Right.
HTC Vive, I mean, is the experience that much better? Granted, with HTC Vive, you get the little... There's not pictures of it on this thing, but you get these little boxes that kind of sit up in the corners, at kind of the two opposite corners of the room, and those track where you're moving and where the headset's moving, and that allows you more range of movement than the Oculus does straight up. I've seen Oculus augmented with stuff like a Kinect to allow for a similar functionality, but out of the box, the HTC Vive does seem to offer that functionality more so than the Oculus does. But is it worth $1,500, considering that you don't just need the HTC Vive, you also need a pretty damn high-end
PC
computer to go along with it. So
yeah.
The question here is just based on some of these actually available in the first quarter or half of this year VR devices, when are you going to buy one? Because you're going to buy one, right?
Duh.
I mean... Kyle and I bought one.
We pre-ordered
the Oculus because we're going to test it and tell you guys if it sucks or not.
Yeah.
But when are you guys going to buy one? Because a lot of people are excited about this stuff, but a lot of people are also hesitant to make a financial investment in the technology. So the answers we have here, which you guys can choose and vote on if you wish, are now or as soon as possible, which means basically you're pre-ordering an Oculus or a Vive.
Right.
Later this year, let's say second half of the year. Let the early adopters, suckers, pay double and work out all the bugs first, which honestly is often the task of the poor early adopters.
True.
Next year, maybe, if they drop the price and make it 1,000 times better. Those are for skeptics in the room.
Yep.
Or whenever a suitable amount of high-grade VR porn is available, which none of you should vote on.
I'm quite partial to that last one.
You can't vote on that one, though. That's
right.
That's our turnip entry. All right, so Kyle, which of these stances would you like to champion? What do you think is the right time to invest in VR?
You know, I feel like I am going against what I believe.
Liar!
But, because I've already pre-ordered one, I'm a little bit biased, but for the sake of argument and to play devil's advocate, I'm going to go with next year. Maybe! If they drop the price and make it 1,000 times better. Because, let's face it, not everyone has access to high-end computer parts like you or I, Paul. We save a lot of money. I remember for my first build ever, I saved a lot of money for 3 or 4 months before I could actually build a high-end system. And that, even today, wouldn't be capable of handling a VR kind of experience that I would like, with like high frame rates and things like that, and good graphics quality. So, yeah, I think $600 is a bit outrageous right now for a headset. You know, a VR headset, but maybe in a year or so, we're going to start to see that price drop down as we start to also see more competition with HTC Vive. I know Razer also has a VR headset coming out not too long from now. So with all that competition, more options, and as supply goes up, we're probably going to start to see a huge incline of MSRP when it comes to an HSM or HMD, headset mounted display, HMD. So me being a rather frugal person most of the time, I would probably save my hard-earned dollars to see where the market lies next year. Because honestly, not only is the price a factor, but they will also, like it says in the straw poll here, you will also be working out some bugs by the time you actually pick one up in 2017 that I'm sure a lot of us early adopters, you and I included, will probably have to suffer through for the first few months of release. So, yeah. Patience is virtue, and I will rest my case at that.
All right. Well, Kyle says next year. Kyle says wait. I don't like waiting, so I'm going to say later this year. My inclination was going to be to say now and reinforce my own personal position, but I feel like I'd have to use too many of the excuses that I made to myself, which was that I make YouTube videos, and being at the forefront of something like this has a lot more benefit, I think, to someone doing a job like I'm doing than somebody who just plays games as a hobby at home. So anyway, later this year. I'll say later this year, let the early adopters, suckers, pay double, work out all the bugs first. Will we see price drops on VR headsets by the end of this year? Maybe. Maybe at the very end of the year. Maybe on first generation headsets.
Christmas.
Maybe Christmas time.
Yeah.
So I would say, yeah, patience is a virtue, and waiting a little bit longer will definitely get you a better situation. I don't think we need to go cow's route and be so conservative as to wait till all the way to next year, because let's be honest, we're ready for VR. I'm tired of this garbage and everything being slow. So later this year, I think, is a good bet, because we're going to see Oculus and HTC Vive both launch by then. We're going to see at least 3 to 6 months of people using them in the wild for bugs to get worked out, software updates, that kind of thing. It'll give us also that much longer for games to be developed for them that are more oriented specifically towards playing with VR headsets. And I think it'll be a better choice all around.
You know, we may be ready for VR, Paul, but I'm not quite convinced yet that VR is ready for us. Let's see the votes.
Let's see people.
On that note,
all right.
Murder.
Results. Yay.
That moment of
all right.
drama.
Kyle wins.
Hey.
Kyle wins with next year. Maybe if they drop the price and make it 1,000 times better.
Hey.
Coming in at a close second with 86 votes is whenever a suitable amount of high-grade VR porn is available. Not quite a few people saying later this year. All right, so it looks like most of you guys are not looking at 2016 as the VR year.
Right.
Which honestly makes tons of sense.
It also makes sense because we haven't really seen single high-end GPUs be able to handle that sort of thing with ease. I mean, yes, it can, but there is some kind of sacrifice that needs to be pulled there. So I think maybe after Pascal and new AMD architecture and things like that, we're going to start to see a lot more people leaning more towards the side of, okay, maybe considering picking up a VR headset now that I actually have the hardware capacity to handle it. So,
damn sensibility and...
sensibility.
Reasonableness.
We're on PC, not Mac, Paul. Come on.
That's true. All right. Let's move on to this one. This one's a little off topic, but hey, I thought I'd throw it in there.
This
Powerball. Holy crap. If you guys are in the United States, you probably heard of this. If you guys are not in the United States, you're probably jelly.
Yeah.
No, no. Powerball.
You're straight jelly, bitches.
Powerball is the nationwide like lottery thing, which is nationwide, and it is $1.5 billion right now.
America!
It was $1.3 yesterday, $1.4 this morning, and it's $1.5 now, and it's probably going to be more tomorrow. Tomorrow is the cutoff for people to buy tickets. It's just a shitload of money.
Yep.
And so the popular thing right now is to say, what would you do if you won Powerball? So that's what we're going to do right now, is vote on what you should do with the Powerball money. We have a variety of selections you guys to choose from.
I'd buy LMG.
So
I'd buy the entire Linus Media Group and make them work for me.
And force Linus to
buy them out.
Just do pies in the face. for Linus,
just be a pie monkey.
Linus's job would be to review pies in the face.
Yeah.
This pie was lovely and sweet.
This one's delicious.
Anyway, sorry for these first two entries. I was hung up on the topic that we discussed earlier on the show. So if you have no idea what the hell those are...
No worries.
It probably means that you weren't paying attention to this article about endohedral fullerenes. Anyway, endofullerenes is what the first option is. Or if you want the most expensive substance in the universe, antimatter.
Yeah.
Because endofullerenes are for poor people.
That shit's baller.
Hookers and blow.
Obviously.
Imported cheeses. Cock and balls. 1.4 billion more Powerball tickets. I actually wrote this when it wasn't at 1.4. So please correct this. This should be 1.5 billion.
Yes. That
more
makes a
Powerball
big difference
tickets, which is what
vote.
Apparently I'm going to vote for right now.
Yeah.
Or investments and shit.
Yeah.
Oh, no. I'm not. Damn it. Not supposed to show that yet. We're going to argue this. What the?
All right.
What are we?
What are we doing? What all right. So I picked last time. You picked this time, Paul.
Okay. Oh gosh.
I know they're all so good.
Is it cock or balls?
Those were my only two choices.
Okay, hookers and blow and poor cheeses.
That was my third and fourth.
I mean, I'll be honest. I would go for a variety of all these things if I actually won. But since it's awesome hardware and we got to choose.
Yeah.
Yeah. 6522547 guys. Sorry if the.
What?
I was trying to post this link. I don't know if the link is going through on YouTube. You know,
really?
It's got, well, YouTube has weird rules about posting links in chat.
Yeah.
Anyway. All right. So
weird.
I'll go for antimatter. I think everyone should invest in antimatter. For one, it's very, very hard to find right now. For two, is nothing really matters ultimately in life.
Which is why.
And antimatter, I think it's just the most hipster way of indicating that to people, to be like, yeah, I won the $1.5 billion Powerball.
I just bought
antimatter because nothing matters. So I think investment in that. Plus, it's the most expensive material in the universe. And typically, when it comes to investing in like fine metals and stuff like that, like remember in 2008 when the economy crashed?
Yes.
What was the best investment?
Porn.
Besides porn.
Houses.
No. 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 No.
Just
precious metals. Precious
just a bunch of metal.
Precious metals.
That's what I was going to say.
Maintain their value.
That was on my mind.
And when the economy is collapsing otherwise. So I have to assume, based on that antimatter would also maintain its value.
Okay.
No matter what the economy did. So I'm saying that long-term investment. Plus, NASA is really invested in, you know, NASA wants that. So you could sell it to NASA. Anyway.
Yeah.
I'm already disappointed with my choice. What do you want, Kyle? What are you going to get?
So I'm going to buy... I'm going to get 1.4 or 1.5 billion more Powerball tickets. That's the obvious... That's really the only obvious choice.
Yes.
Because then you just multiply, like, almost infinitely your odds of winning the next Powerballs and all future lotteries. I mean, you could buy the entire lottery, like... It just guarantees that you're going to win. And the more lottery tickets you buy, the higher the stakes are and the higher the payout. So essentially, you're almost like doing like a kind of weird investment type thing where you're just monopolizing the entire lottery system of the United States. And it just gets you filthy rich. And then with all that money, finally, then you can do investments in shit, cock and balls, everything else, hookers and blow. It's all good stuff. Definitely the cheeses. I'm a huge cheese fan.
I love
and,
cheese.
Why settle for a bunch of cheese when you could have like a shit ton of cheese from buying a shit ton of Powerball tickets?
It's a compelling argument.
Thank you.
All right. Let's see what everyone thought.
I win.
I'm going to refresh this, make sure the results are accurate.
Mm.
Most people are saying investments and shit.
Interesting.
Just do some investments and shit.
Going the responsible
with,
route.
With a close second for hookers and blow.
Yes, we definitely obviously. A polarizing audience that we have.
Obviously.
Right. Like ones with families and the ones that are single or hey, you never know. There could be some crossover.
Of the ones we debated, antimatter.
Antimatter definitely won.
Right up there.
Yep.
Oh, yeah. And pretty cheeses.
It's pretty fucking close.
How much cheese could you get for $1.5 billion?
Goodness.
That'd be some good cheese. Ooh, we just had an upset here down below. I didn't see what happened, but 1.4 billion more Powerball tickets and balls are really fighting it out here.
Cock is clearly the more popular choice than balls.
Cock, but definitely people want more cock than balls.
Yeah,
I'm gonna keep that in mind. That's a good thing. It's a good thing to know for future reference.
I'm gonna frame my channel content based on these results. Very insightful.
Thank you, Kyle. That's something that I felt really needed to be resolved.
Yes.
Via sword fight. So, thank you guys all for participating in that.
Yes.
We're going to move on to the final segment, which is a pretty open Q&A section.
Let's make this quick because I got to pee again.
Which is also, Q&A is still tech of the day after tomorrow. I haven't fixed that yet. It's supposed to say Q&A, but it says tech of the day after tomorrow and Kyle's going to...
But at least I can lick it.
But Kyle can eat some ice cream.
Mm.
All right, so guys, if you have any questions and you want to send them over to us, we're looking specifically right now at YouTube chat, Twitter chat.
Yeah, let's do a lightning round.
And YouTube, Twitter, and Twitch.
Go, 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 go,
go. All of those things we're kind of keeping an eye on right now.
Blast it.
Theoretically, so.
Blast it.
If you guys have the questions, we have the answers.
Maybe.
Brought to you for your viewing pleasure. Blade Stealth, Razor Blade Stealth, buy or no buy? Kyle, you had hands-on time with it.
I looked at it from the looks, from the surface level, yes. From actually getting to know the product and taking a closer look, probably not. I really do like the form factor. I think it's super sleek and stealthy, of course. But the one issue that I have with it, if it is going to be tailored for gaming, it's only a dual core with 4 threads. That's
bad.
A deal breaker for me.
Yeah, that's pretty
bad. I don't know why they dropped the ball on that so hard, but I felt like that was a given. Like, if you're going to make it for gaming, make it quad core.
Yeah, probably mostly to do with keeping that super, super thin, sleek profile and everything that it has, which is cool.
And to up the battery life, probably, for sure.
But yeah, for a system that has, like, this awesome feature of this external GPU dock that you can connect via Thunderbolt with a USB Type-C connector, which is super sweet.
Yeah.
Pairing whatever high-end graphics card you do in there with a dual-core mobile processor kind of takes a lot of the wind out of my sails as well.
Yes.
Okay. My high-end water-cooled build should be ketchup and mustard themed, according to Andre 3200.
That would be pretty sweet.
Thank you, Andre.
I like that.
I could go for that. We'll do like a yellow fluid for one for like the CPU and a red fluid for the GPU.
Yeah.
And put just French fries inside there so that you can eat French fries whenever
ketchup
you want.
And mustard.
I want French fries.
Perfect condiments for fries. Sneaksy Corsair after party? Yes.
Playing some games. We're gonna do some post show gaming on either of our Twitch channels. So my channel is Paul's Hardware. Kyle's channel is Awesome Sauce
Network. Yep.
On Twitch, we aren't gonna game. Aren't gonna do that immediately. We're going to eat some dinner, and then Kyle's going to head home. But we're going to be doing a little bit of gaming later this evening, so watch our Twitches.
Yes.
And we will let you guys know when we go live and all that good stuff.
As a Vegu, Kyle, can you touch your toes with your nose? I could, but I'd probably pee.
Yeah, that sounds uncomfortable.
There'd be a leak.
Is Skylake worth it, says JMCWD.
Depends what you have.
Yeah, it really depends what you have right now. If you have Ivy Bridge or Haswell or Devil's Canyon, it's like the newer you're working with right now, the less compelling of an upgrade it is. If you're working with something super old, if you're like Sandy Bridge or older, I mean, even Sandy Bridge, if you're overclocking, is still very, very capable. But if you're Sandy Bridge or older, yes. If you're on anything older from AMD, for sure. But again, very specifically, if you're upgrading for CPU specific reasons, if you do a lot of rendering or that kind of thing,
yeah,
then it will be much more effective.
Mission Minded 07, would you smoke weed with Dre if he offered to smoke you out? I would probably do anything Dre told me to do.
You don't have any other choice in that situation. It's Dre.
Yeah. Come on.
What else?
Obviously.
If you won Powerball, would you buy a new egg? No.
Probably not.
No, I would not.
No.
I don't think that's a great investment right now.
I'd buy a company to rival them. I'd buy a company to rival
Amazon. I'd buy Amazon. Sure.
Yeah,
I'd buy Amazon's worth a little bit more than that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Wait for Pascal or get a 980 Ti and sell it when Pascal comes out. Pascal's around the corner. Wait for Pascal. Patience is virtue.
Yeah?
Should Kyle... I mean, a 980 Ti, I mean...
Depends how much money you're willing to give up, because if you buy a 980 Ti right now and you sell it in 6 months, you'll probably lose.
You'll lose a lot.
So if you buy it for $650 right now, you'll probably still be able to sell it for $500-ish.
Yeah.
Is $150 or so dollars worth it for you to use that for 6 months before you upgrade to the next version?
Depends on how much you game.
Yeah, how much you game, how much money you have, all that kind of stuff.
What your monitor is, all that
stuff. But consider it that way. Like, you can have a generally good idea of how much you'll be able to sell that once the next generation comes out. You won't be able to sell it for as much. You'll definitely have to sell it for cheaper.
Yeah.
But, yeah, look at it that way. Say, is that much money lost worth it for me to be able to use that card for X amount of months?
Right.
Yeah.
Maseo T, 5820K or 6700K for a multi-purpose / gaming PC? Honestly, they're pretty, more or less, close in price. I think the 5820K offers you more bang for the buck. It also gets you on Haswell E, so you get X99. And I think with the story that we were just talking about earlier with Broadwell E coming out, if you wanted to upgrade that CPU to a Broadwell E processor in the future, you could do that on that platform. 6700K, just, I don't know, if you can afford the few extra, whatever, few dollars that it costs, the 5820K is a better option with more cores, more threads, more PCIe lanes, and all around a better chip.
If you are only worried about gaming, then go for Skylake. Go for the 6700K or 6600K.
Unless you just like being badass.
No, don't get me wrong. I'm always an advocate for the enthusiast platform. I think it's an awesome thing to jump up to.
Yes.
You spend more money, though. And when it comes strictly to gaming, you don't get quite as much bang for the buck. But for everything else, for all the other stuff you might do, because per thread performance on Skylake is better than Haswell E. So
you might be a higher upgrade path though on X99 than on Z170.
You'll have more to upgrade to?
Yeah.
Not necessarily, because Z170 has already been promised Kaby Lake.
Oh, I guess that's true.
So both X99 2011-3, which is the enthusiast level platform, and Z170 socket 1151, which is the mainstream platform, both of those right now have promised new CPU lines coming out for them later this year. Probably
Kaby Lake's still not going to be as good as Broadwell E, though.
I have no idea.
It would be nice.
I think it is absolutely too early to say.
Okay, maybe.
Yeah.
Perhaps.
But who knows?
True. Let's see what else. Make an egg on a CPU.
Here, that guy too says, I have a 750 Ti and an i3-4170. Which should I upgrade first? That guy too, I'm assuming you're asking about gaming.
Yeah.
What were his two? It's a pretty low-end i3, like an original Haswell i3, I think. And a 750 Ti. That is a good question.
Upgrade your i3.
Upgrade the i3?
Yeah.
That's a very good question.
750 Ti still can handle some shit, believe it
or not.
Yeah,
750 Ti is pretty capable. It is Maxwell-based.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
The thing is, if you're going to upgrade both of them at the same time.
I almost want to say that, too. Because it's hard to say which of those two. Because either way, if you upgrade to something current generation or like much higher end, the other one is going to be holding the other one back.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, and also, we have some exciting upcoming launches on the CPU side as well as the GPU side coming this year. So, it's always a situation where you might say, you know what, if you need to upgrade now, then if you absolutely have to upgrade now, then I have to make a call between one or two of those. But otherwise, I would say keep saving a little cash, work with what you got, and give a little time. Because I always like getting the newest generation of hardware when it launches.
Right.
Hey, Pup Shepherd, thanks for the donation over on YouTube. Appreciate that.
Thanks, sir.
He says he has an FX8350 combined with a 980 Ti. How future-resistant is my CPU for games? You're doing pretty decent. Yeah. An 8350 is still pretty solid. If you ever clock it, even better.
Just put a nice cooler on that guy.
But definitely, I would say hang on to that 980 Ti and look at the AMD and the Intel stuff coming out this year.
Yeah.
And maybe consider upgrading that base platform. Mainly because with an FX8350, you're looking at AM3 Plus motherboards. It's just your base hardware is getting more and more out of date. So you're not going to have as much access to stuff like DDR4 or M.2 memory slots or U.2 or NVMe support for adding in super high speed storage and that kind of thing.
Yeah.
That's kind of like more of the exciting stuff, even more so than the CPU performance or individual per core performance.
Right.
Just all the new technology that you get with a motherboard that came out last week versus 2 or 3 years ago.
Assuming you will be taking advantage of all those features. And that you actually need them.
Yes.
And you'll see a performance bump from them.
Yes, yes.
2970s
or 1980 Ti? 1980 Ti. Always go with the single best GPU you can get before you consider going SLI or Crossfire. That's my general advice. Even if you can get some better raw performance out of the Crossfire or SLI setup.
It's not as consistent.
Yeah, the consistency, the lack power of performance in some games that don't have SLI or Crossfire support, power efficiency, all of those things weigh in. So I always
heat,
go...
Heat, and heat in your chassis. Yeah. Very important.
And it'll just, you'll have a much smoother experience with a single GPU.
Will Gaines, thank you for the $2 donation. Do you think they'll be branding the Pascal XX80 GPU as 1080, or will they do something different with the branding as to not associate it with 1080p?
That's a good question. So he's saying if they go from a 980 to 1080, do you think they'll call it 1080?
I think that might be kind of weird, just because 1080 is also very associated with the resolution, and I feel like NVIDIA's marketing team might be thinking about, like, what's the best nomenclature to go with in terms of, like, search engine optimization, right? If people are searching for this, are they going to, like, start finding, like, 1080p resolution as opposed to our video card? Like, it's competing. You're essentially having two keywords that are competing with each other in a marketing sense. And it also just kind of puts this weird image in your head that doesn't necessarily jump to NVIDIA GPU.
Yeah.
So I personally think they're going to come up with something more clever or creative about it, but you never know. They could just be like, fuck it, we're going all in, 1080, it's going to be cool.
Yeah.
I don't really know.
I've seen NVIDIA as well as ATI/AMD switch back and forth between 3-digit and 4-digit numbers to name their GPUs. Like, for instance, there was an NVIDIA 7800 GT and a 7800 GTX before they switched back to the 200 series and the 300 series and all that kind of stuff.
Right.
I could see this as a very prime time for NVIDIA to just completely change up the naming conventions that they're using for their graphics cards, or to go back to a four, like maybe they'll go four to four digit. Maybe they'll just change completely. That's a very good point about the 1080 conflict there, and I could see them thinking about that as well and not wanting to do that, especially if they're saying, like, this is a card for 4K. It's called the 1080.
Right.
I would not be at all surprised if they went with a completely different naming convention.
True.
Yep.
Sweet, but oh boy. I have to pee.
Okay, Kyle has to pee. Guys, we're going to cut the show off. Thank you all so much for joining us. Shout out to John Miller. Thanks for that last-minute donation, sir.
Yes.
Intel Integrated Graphics Master Race, for sure. Yes,
and Juan.
And Warren Vargas, who said, do you get the full proceeds of YouTube donations? As far as I know, yeah, the donations are direct, but I'm not absolutely for sure about that.
I'll have to double-check.
But thanks, you guys, for donating anyway. Really appreciate that. We'll be back again next week on Tuesday evening at 5:30 p.m. Pacific time with more awesome hardware.
And we'll even be back later tonight for a live stream.
Yes.
For
so again, twitch.tv/awesomesaucenetwork, twitch.tv/paulshardware is where we will be streaming. You can follow us each on Twitter at our Twitter handles down there as well. And we'll tweet when we go live and all the good stuff. And we really appreciate you guys joining us.
Yes.
And we're really, I don't know, I'm very excited about 2016.
Me too.
I think there's wonderful things happening this year.
Feeling some good chi.
Yeah, we got lots of cool hardware coming out, and we have lots of fabulous stuff planned for both of our channels. So appreciate you guys all stopping by.
Yeah.
And I'm going to cut off the show before I stutter or slur any more speech.
Have a good night, guys.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.